Okay. In our review of the development of Jewish law, we came to the period of Rabbi Yosef Karo and the Bet Yosef and the Shulchan Aruch. And it's important to dwell more a little bit on the Shulchan Aruch, because after the whole process of development, we sort of got to that end of the line with the Shulchan Aruch. That today everybody says, I follow the Shulchan Aruch. This is, if you want to challenge a certain halakha, people say, but what did Shulchan Aruch say about that? So we have to look at the background and the rationale of writing the Shulchan Aruch. So previously we spoke about the Arba'at Turim, the work of Rabbeinu Yaakov ben Rabbeinu Asher, who organized all the halachic material in four columns, one dealing with daily life, Orach Hayim, one dealing with marital issues, Evan Ezer, one with monetary laws and the laws of judges, called Choshen Mishpat, and one dealing with Kashrut, Nida, and stuff like that, called Yoreh Da'ah. And we mentioned that he organized the material sort of like an encyclopedia. Didn't technically give a final verdict of what the halakha is, but rather brought the opinion with long-winded arguments like, this one says A, B, C, and it's hard for someone to read that and come to a conclusion. Now, Rabbi Yosef Karo, when he reviewed what existed before him, he found out that he has two extremes. On one hand, the Rambam, Maimonides, who has one opinion, no sources, but gives you the clear final halakha. On the other hand, you have the tool, the Arba'at Turim, which gives you all the opinions, but doesn't give you the final verdict. He also realized that the book of Maimonides was not widely accepted, even though people studied it, but they did not follow it in all communities, because he didn't give people options. Now, the advantage of Rabbi Yosef Karo in that sense was that during his travels, he got, because of the expulsions from Spain, the family wandered from place to place, he was able to be exposed to different cultures. He spent a lot of time in a city called Edirne. Back then it was called Adrianopolis. It was on the Greek side of Turkey. So he spent time in Edirne and in other places in the Balkans, and he studied with the leading sages of the Balkan Jewry. But also got in touch with the Kabbalists from Portugal and Spain. His father-in-law, Rabbi Yitzhak Sabah, was a Kabbalist. So we got exposed to different customs, different practices, including the study of Kabbalah. And he came to the conclusion that he has to write this major work that will accumulate, that will put together all the halakhic material, and that will be accessible for everyone. What he did, unlike Maimonides, the first step that he took is to open up all the sources in front of people. So he wrote a commentary on the book of Rabbi Yaakov ben Asher, which is called Arba'at Turim. He wrote a commentary called Bet Yosef, the house of Yosef, based on the pasuk in Bereshit, in Genesis, when it says Vayuvu Anashim Bet Yosef, the people, the brothers of Yosef, were brought to the house of Yosef. So that's where the name Bet Yosef is taken from. And he wrote a commentary on Maimonides called Kesef Mishneh, second money. Sort of, that's the literal translation, but that's also taken from the story of Yosef and his brothers, that when they came back to visit Yosef, they brought Kesef Mishneh Beyadam. They brought an additional money because their payment was sent back with them, so they brought more money. So both his names are related to the story of Yosef as king, and it has sort of like a subliminal message of the way he perceived his work. He sees himself as royalty, because he knew what he had to offer. But you know, the names of his books are related to Yosef, who was the viceroy. So he sees himself as at a very important position, but recognizes that in a way he's second to the Rambam, to Maimonides. And let's see, look at his introduction, and we'll see what brought him to write the book, and how did he approach the work. So he starts with a brief description of like Jewish history. Hashem chose us and gave us the Torah, etc., etc. And then he says, "It's vayhi ki aruchu lanu hayamim, huraknu mikeli el keli, uvagola alachnu." Says with the time that has passed, we were poured from one vessel to another vessel. That's a metaphor for being exiled, for diaspora. It is the original image is that of wine. When you pour wine from one vessel to another, especially in ancient times, it loses its special flavor and aroma because it has to be with all its ingredients. So to pour wine from vessel to vessel means that there's no connection to the original source and that something is lost in the process. And he says, and we went to exile, v'chama tzarot tzurot, and we had so many disasters and persecutions. Techufot v'tzarot zo lazo. They were one after another. V'tzarot zo lazo, meaning they don't get along with each other. Meaning sometimes there are contradicting events in a way that you don't have time to rest from one, the other one attacks you, so you don't know where to go. So happened to the Jews of Spain. They moved from Spain to Portugal after the expulsion. And a short while later, about 2 years later, the king of Portugal joined the decree of the Inquisition and said, either you convert to Christianity or you leave. They left to the New World, some to the Ottoman Empire and to the Netherlands. But those who went to the New World, the Inquisition went and set offices there. So it was very difficult for the Jews. In the New World, in Brazil. In Brazil, in South America. So because of that, nitkayem banu ba'avonotenu ve'avedah chokhmat hachamav. And because of that, we got to the point where the verse in the prophecies of doom that the wisdom of the wise men will be lost is now fulfilled in us. And you realize this is the same argument of Maimonides in the 1100s, same argument of Rabbeinu Yaakov and Rabbeinu Asher in the 1300s, and now it's Rabbi Yosef Karo in the 1500s. So every generation comes and justifies the writing of the law by saying that we have no more wise people, nobody knows how to study Torah.
What's so, the text of the Musaf of the Halidis? Because of
So that's that concept of we acknowledge how difficult it is to be in the, and there's no question that the our wanderings through the Gola were very tough for the Jewish people, but the image of this story of like nobody knows how to study anymore is not necessarily accurate. Not when Maimonides says it, not when Rabbi Yaakov or when Rabbi Yosef Karo says it. Because there were always scholars, there were always wise people, and you could say even to the contrary. The more Am Yisrael was persecuted, the more the scholars focused on the learning of Torah and promulgation of knowledge, because they realized that this is the only tool that we have and we can use against our adversaries. And it did prove itself. As I always say, that the fact that we came back to Eretz Yisrael, we did what we did. We build the state. We have scientists and technology and all that, is because of that deep notion of learning and educating our children that was always there in the Jewish people. So they were always wise people. But anyway, Rabbi Yosef Karo decided to take on that. We'll see later on that not everybody agreed with him that this is needed. There were other great rabbis at the time. Ironically, two of them were also Yosef. One is Rabbi Yosef Taitatzek. And the other one was Ma'ari Berav, Rabbi Yosef Berav, in Tzifat, but we'll get to it later. So he says this, Ve'azla yad ha-Torah ve'lomdeha, ki lo na'aset ha-Torah ki-shte torot, ela ke-torot en mispar. When Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi wrote the Mishnayot, it's about 1300 years before Rabbi Yosef Karo, he said, we have to write the Mishnah down so the Torah will not become two Torahs, we will not have two different schools. Rabbi Yosef Karo says, now it's not two. It says Torot and Mispar. There's an infinite number of Torahs. Each one has his Torah. Lesibat Rov Asfarim Anim Beveu Mishpatei Avedinia. Because you have so many books which explain from so many explanations, you can't see the core. As they say in Hebrew, Merov Etzim Lo Rim Tayar, because you can't see the forest because of the trees. Avegam Ki Hem Aleim Hashalom Kavanatam Hayta Le'ayir Machshakenu. Nimshach Lanu Mitoch Haor Hatov She'einenu Mehem Safek U'Mevucha Rabba. He says, even though the authors that preceded me had the good intention to shed light on the world of halacha, they caused more confusion and doubt. How is that possible? He says, "Biyot kol echad mechaber sefer la'atzmo, v'chofel ma shekvar katav v'chiber mi shekedamo." And here he touches upon a serious problem that is still plagues the rabbinical world in the terms of writing halacha, that and not only the rabbinical, but by the way, also in the legal system, this is a problem. It's the problem of using precedent and the lack of the ability to clearly write. Meaning, if I write about something that was already written before, do I have to quote the whole original source? Or if I do not present a new opinion, then why am I writing what I'm writing? If it's there is a way to clearly write and say, there are three opinions, A, B, C, just sum it up in bullet points, and then go on to analyze and present the opinion that you want to present. I mean, this tactic, when it's used by kids in high school, we understand. They have to fill two or three more pages for their paper, so they put it there. I've seen examples of that, but clear writing is not simple. It's an art. Actually, there's one yeshiva today in Israel, only one yeshiva, that still follows the traditional Sephardic school of thought of how to teach, and that's Yeshivat Kisei Rahamim, led by Rabbi Meir Mazuz in Bnei Brak. And part of the curriculum of the yeshiva is that the students must write a psak halacha, halachic verdict. The rabbi presents them with a case, and they have to write an argument to determine whether, you know, what is the decision, what do you do in this case. And he reviews it, and he says, okay, you have to clear that, you have to... And when you look at the halachic writings of today, before we go back to Beit Yosef, Rabbi Ovadia Yosef, for example, is considered the one of the leading poskim of the recent generations, but his writing is very cumbersome, because for every concept that he brings up, he will bring 100 sources, and they're in the body of the text. So you lose your way in those arguments. And if he brings this concept more than once, he wouldn't say, look at what I wrote at... No, he will say it again. So it's a problem. But at the time of Rabbi Yosef Karo, it was even more difficult, because there were many books were in manuscripts. The printing press was just invented in the late 1400s by Johann Gutenberg in Germany. And it wasn't easy to cross-reference books. You had to really be knowledgeable and know all material in order to have a good command of that. So, kol mechaber, mechaber sefer la'atzmo. Each author goes and writes his own book. V'chofer ma shekvar katav v'chiber mishekedamo. And he repeats unnecessarily stuff that text that was written in other books. O kotev adin be'efech ma shekatavo havero v'lo yazkir dvarav. Or he writes an opinion which is opposed to a different opinion, which is a widespread, but he doesn't refer to the other opinion. Like he says, for example, on Shavuot you eat meat. That's it. It doesn't mention anyone who says that Shavuot you eat dairy. So that causes confusion. So one reads that and says, wait, am I doing right or wrong? And because of that, when people quote a previous book, they rely on that one opinion that was mentioned without mentioning the other opposing opinions. And then you think, oh, that is agreed on by all. But if you really dig into the history of the halakha, like Rabbi Yosef Karo says he did, which he did, you will find that there is a dispute on that, and not everybody agrees on that. And it says, so what would be the solution for that? אם יאמר אדם, בכל דין שיצטרך לחקור שורשו ומוצאו בדברי הגמרא והמפרשים והפוסקים כולם, יכבד הדבר עליו מאוד. So now that he presented the problem, he says, I know that some of the readers would say, okay, so every time I want to learn the halakha, I'm going to go and research the whole history, and I'll know what to do. He says, that's very difficult. כל שכן, כי אלא למצוא הפתח לדעת מקום הדין בתלמוד. He uses a verse from the story of the angels in Sodom, when the people of Sodom tried to attack Lot. So they were blinded by the angels, and they couldn't find the door. So Rabbi Yosef Karo says, Yile elim zu apeta. He wouldn't be able to find the door, meaning the gate into the Talmud, the original source. And that's another, we'll see that's another tactic that probably subliminal, to make the task so daunting and so difficult that the rationale for the book is justified. We have to write that because nobody could access the halakha. And he says, even though we have other books, which he mentions here, Rav Magid, Rabbeinu Yerucham, some of these books are too concise, some of them are too verbose, so it's hard to find the right balance. And he says, even gam ki yada mekom adin bagmara. Now let's say that you want to know a certain halakha, and you say, I'm going to go all the way back to the Talmud. This is why we started this class, by the way, right? You said, I want to know what is the hierarchy of halakha. How do I find out the right thing to do? So let's say I say, I'm going to go back to the Talmud. I want to see what is the source. And let's say that you found the source. And remember, all this is without Google or anything like that. So you really have to and not only before Google. Before there were pages, numbers of pages for the Gemara. This is at the time when people were referencing to a source in the Talmud, they couldn't say, look at page number this. Today it's like Daf Ayin Gimel Amud Bet, page 73, side A, side B. They didn't have that. They said, look at chapter. This tract of this chapter. Some chapters are short, some are 30 pages long. So you go through, you leaf through the page to find one word. It's very difficult. So he says, but even if you found it, you'll have to learn the discussion in the Talmud with the commentaries of Rashi, Tosafot, Rif, Rosh, Ran, Mordechi, Rambam. So he mentions all these rabbis that are from Rashi to the Mordechi. They span about 200 years. And then Sh'ar Poskim, but then also the works of the halachic authorities. וגם בדברי תשובות הגדולים הנמצאות אצלו, לדעת אם הדין הוא מוסכם מהכל. So, and you have to find all the details of the halakha and see if everybody agrees on that. And he says, ואם בדין הבא ליד האדם כך, במי שרוצה לדע שורשי כל הדינים על בוריים, he says, this is regarding one halakha, one law. What if you wanted to know everything? על אחד כמה וכמה שיבצר ממנו, it's an impossible task. That even if you go after the source of each and every halakha, הוא תורח גדול מאוד והשכחה מצויה באדם, that it's not an easy task and we tend to forget. ומה גם בדברים רבי ההסתעפות, there are many ramifications to each halakha, ונמצא יגיע לריק חז ושלום. So רבי יוסף קארו, at this part of the introduction, basically says, with the literature that we have today, it is impossible for a common person to know what to do. And so he lays the foundations for it to say, my book is needed, and that's why I'm going to present it to you, and the literature that we have so far is insufficient. We'll continue tomorrow with an introduction.